Graphic Audio. A movie in your mind. Graphic Audio presents Rogue Angel by Alex Archer. Rogue Angel number 54, Day of Atonement. Narrated by Nanette Savard. With performances by Colleen Delany, Richard Rowan, Terence Aselford, Stephen Carpenter, Susan Linsky, Gregory Linington, Chris Davenport, Christopher Graybill, Matthew Bassett, Chris Genebach, Bradley Smith, Todd Scofield, Eric Messner, Kimberly Gilbert, Alyssa Wilmoth, Evan Casey, and Nora Achrati.
On a winter's night, 20 years ago.
All right. You have my attention.
The young man who sat across from him had been insistent, refusing to be put off no matter how many times Rue ducked the meeting. That dogged persistence paid off, eventually. He regretted that decision now, particularly that he had invited him into his home. Something about the intense young man's scrutiny was decidedly uncomfortable. It wasn't so much the stare as it was the slight twitch of his lower lip, like it was fighting back the urge to smile. It made his skin crawl. One thing the years had done for Rue was to offer an education in human nature. He liked to think himself a reasonable judge of character. This boy, because that's what he was really, a boy in man's clothing, was somehow off.
I thought I might, eventually.
Sure, how can I help you?
I suspect it's more a case of how I can help you.
He settled a briefcase on the Louis XIV coffee table that acted as a barrier between them. The young man pushed the case back an inch and thumbed the locks. It was all Rue could do not to reach out and slap the stupid boy. The table was a priceless work of art. The briefcase was not.
I wasn't aware that I needed any help.
Then allow me to enlighten you, Monsieur Rue.
He drew a manila folder out of the briefcase. Rue picked up the business card the young man had given him when he first turned up at his door. Patrice Merlin, freelance journalist. After the seventh call, he had done his due diligence and had some of his people run background checks on the man that would have made the CIA envious. And by the time he had finally agreed to the sit-down, Rue knew almost everything there was to know about Patrice Merlin, and had his own dossier almost twice as thick as the folder the journalist pulled from his briefcase.
I saw this picture of you in a magazine.
He handed over the first clipping. Rue had seen it before. He had been disappointed that the photograph had been published, but it couldn't be helped. The photograph had been taken at a charity event organized by an old friend, and obligations to the social compact necessitated he attend, because that's what friends did. He'd been promised it was going to be a low-key gathering, but the late edition of one of those Hollywood darlings with two blonde hair and an impossibly plastic smile and her politico bow had transformed it into an irresistible honeypot for the paparazzi.
Not the most flattering, I'll grant you, but hardly a crime against humanity. I rarely accept invitations to events like that, but you know how it is. Sometimes it's hard to say no.
I understand. The thing is, seeing it, I couldn't help but think your face looked familiar.
I have one of those faces, isn't that what they say? It's embarrassing sometimes because everyone thinks they've seen me before, or that I remind them of someone else.
Which is what I thought at first. In my line of work, I see a lot of faces, so I decided to check, just to be sure.
So, who did you think I reminded you of?
No one in particular. Not some celebrity, at least. But I had this nagging feeling that I'd seen you in another picture.
He picked up the next piece of paper from the folder and handed it over. Rue remembered the picture being taken, even if he had forgotten the joke that had put a smile on everyone's lips a long time ago.
Here's Bobby Kennedy, JFK, and someone beside them. A third man, who you must admit bears a striking resemblance to you.
Well, there's certainly a resemblance, but I hate to disappoint you. I've never had the privilege of meeting either of the Kennedys.
That's a shame. But maybe this one is a little more familiar.
This one was slightly out of focus, but Rue remembered the night well. He'd forgotten a lot of the others in the photograph, but knew the man on the right, Paul Reynaud, the president of France. It had been taken a few months before the outbreak of World War II. Rue stood behind Reynaud's shoulder. He had been less cautious then, less concerned about being seen in public, because the proliferation of cameras was nothing like it was today, and the chances of being caught and remembered from one image to the next were almost nil. Only now, Rue had been remembered, and the journalist had followed a trail of photographs into his past and found him impossibly unchanged, despite the 70 years between the first and the last picture.
It could be the same man in both photographs.
I'm absolutely sure it is, Monsieur Rue. It's you, after all.
He produced another picture, a sepia-tinged photograph of the Russian royal family. Rue was there again.
Do I really need to show you more? I have them, plenty of them. Enough, I'm sure, to convince you.
I'm not sure what you're trying to say. You can't possibly think these are all of me. They date back nearly 100 years. That's impossible.
And yet, that's you in each of those pictures, unable to resist the allure of power, rubbing shoulders with the rich and famous. As you say, there's more than 100 years between some of these photographs, and yet there you are in all of them. And, most interestingly, you haven't changed a bit. I would ask you what the secret of your young skin is, but I'm assuming it's not some moisturizer.
A good story, but for one fatal flaw. It's not me in those pictures, no matter how similar the men are. How could it be me?
You're denying it?
Merlin gathered up the pictures.
I am simply pointing out that you are mistaken.
And that's your final word?
Rue rubbed a hand over his face.
I really don't think there's anything else to say.
He pushed himself to his feet, indicating their meeting was over. He wasn't about to sit and debate the impossibility of longevity, never mind immortality, with Merlin, when he risked betraying himself with some careless word that would only strengthen the young man's case.
Then you'll have no objection to me running the story, then?
What story? There is no story.
Perhaps. Perhaps not. We'll let the members of the public make up their own minds, shall we? Isn't that the joy of a free press?
I'm not sure I'd call making up some fanciful story anything more than irresponsible, Monsieur Merlin. It certainly isn't journalism.
Well, I'm going to be in Paris for a couple of days. Think about it. I'll leave these copies of the photographs with you so you can go through them at your leisure. I do hope you will decide that you'd like to talk to me about this miracle, Monsieur Rue. You have my number.
The man got to his feet and held out his hand. Reluctantly, Rue shook it, then walked the man to the front door.
Think about it. Good night.
The more he made of the situation, the harder it would be to brush it aside as some bizarre flight of fancy. People didn't live forever. It was impossible. But then, so much about his life was impossible. Rue needed time to think about this. It would be easy to pull a few strings and make sure that the story was squashed before there was any danger of it being printed. No one made it to Rue's age without collecting an awful lot of favors owed. It helped that the story sounded utterly preposterous. As the fog folded around the journalist's car, Rue made his way to his study to begin making calls.
Hello?
You absolute bastard!
Rue had ignored Merlin's calls, and when they finally appeared to stop, assumed he'd gotten the message. There wasn't a serious magazine or newspaper in the world that would touch the story. A few of the editors had humored Merlin and admitted that yes, it was curious, wasn't it? But curious or not, it wasn't for them. A few that Rue knew personally had laughed in the young man's face. Rue said nothing.
It's not going to work. You can't gag me no matter who you know. I'll find someone who will publish this story. The truth will come out.
Look, I don't know what you think you know, but believe me, you don't. There's no story to sell. Let it go. Don't make an enemy of me, son.
You think you are so clever, don't you? You think that you have it all worked out. What you don't get is that the whole world will want to know your story. How can someone live for so long without aging? I'm not naive enough to think you signed some kind of pact with the devil, but something is going on. That is you in those photographs. I know it is. I'll prove it.
I'm sorry that you've wasted time on this.
Fine. I'll begin my story by telling everyone how I've been muzzled. That makes for a compelling beginning. How someone, you, didn't want this story out in the public domain. That just makes it more interesting, doesn't it? Why would you want this kept secret unless you had something to hide? You can try to ridicule me and make me look like a fool, but I won't be silenced. There are other ways to tell this story. There are bulletin boards and chat rooms that would devour this type of thing, giving it a life of its own. All I have to do is log in and start to tell the world everything I know. It's not about money anymore. It's about the truth. Oh, you've misjudged me, Monsieur Roux, if you think that all I care about is money. I didn't turn up on your doorstep trying to blackmail you. I came looking for answers.
And that was a mistake.
Merlin was right. With so many people having access to computers and those machines somehow connecting like some giant message network, it was so much more dangerous for a man like him. This was escalating too quickly. The risk now was that it would slip out of his control. There were strings he could pull, more favors he could call in, but once the story had a life of its own, there was no way he could put that genie back in the bottle. And that was what those bulletin boards and chat rooms promised to do. Which meant he had to find another way to stop the story. He needed to speak to someone who understood this electronic world and the very real damage that could be done if he were to be exposed. There was one obvious choice, but it wasn't exactly an easy call to make.
Please leave a message at the sound of the tone.
Call me.
There was nothing more to say. Garin Braden, his former pupil, would recognize his voice and understand just how important it was that they talk simply because he'd swallowed his pride and reached out. He thought about ignoring the situation and hoping the mess would just go away. The more he fought against it, the more obvious it was that he had something to hide after all. But what if it didn't go away? What if those damned photographs led to more journalists banging on his door, asking more and more questions he couldn't answer? He hadn't asked for this life, even if, looking around him at the riches he had acquired across the centuries, it might look like a blessing rather than a curse. All it would take was the wrong person digging deep enough, and everything would begin to unravel. The last thing he wanted to do was to have to begin a new life somewhere else. It was getting harder and harder to do that in this era of powerful computers and international cooperation. His world, and Garin's, was in danger of falling apart. He picked up his phone again.
Yes?
Monsieur Malin, you are right. We should meet. I will be in Paris in a couple of hours.
I'm so glad you've come to your senses, Monsieur Roux. But things have changed since the last time we spoke.
How so?
Remuneration, Monsieur Roux.
Ah, so despite all of your protestations, this is about money then. I'm disappointed.
Ah, don't be. I'm a child of the modern age. The modern age, as I'm sure you have noticed, is an expensive place to live. Let's make it the top of the Eiffel Tower, shall we? 11 a.m. tomorrow.
Roux knew blackmail was a dirty business. Once it started, there was never an end to it. Which, unfortunately for Merlin, meant it needed to end very differently. It was a long climb. There were a dozen tourists already on the viewing platform by the time Roux reached it. There was no sign of Patrice Merlin. Roux's plane had been refueled and would be ready to leave Orly Airport at a moment's notice if things went the way he assumed they would, and he would need to distance himself from the city for a while. A glance at his watch, an eerily precise Patek Philippe chronograph, showed that he was almost 5 minutes early. A couple of tourists glanced in his direction, no doubt wondering why he had made the dizzying climb up the iron stairs and wasn't leaning over the rail to take in the view across the city.
Are you afraid of heights? You can't fall out, you know. You'd have to climb and jump because of the railings, so it's really safe.
That's good to know.
Come on, Billy. No talking to strangers.
Bye!
Roux checked his watch again. 90 seconds. Still no sign of Merlin. and no sign of him on the stairs below, working his way up to the platform. This wasn't good. He couldn't control the situation. He didn't like it when he couldn't control the situation. Another handful of tourists emerged from the elevator, but the journalist wasn't among them. Rue still wasn't used to the fact that technology had advanced so quickly over the past few years that it was possible to carry a phone around wherever you were in the world, even if reception was patchy.
Where are you?
I'm at the foot of the tower.
I am not in the mood for games, Monsieur Merlin. You said the observation platform. I am on the observation platform. You are not. How am I supposed to trust you if you can't even keep this simple agreement? This does not augur well for our relationship.
What can I say? I changed my mind. I wanted to know how serious you were. Now I know.
Seriously? I'm trying to save your career by preventing you from making a fool of yourself, and you'll treat me like an idiot.
Save me? Save yourself, you mean. You misjudged me, Monsieur Roux. It was never about the money. I've only ever been interested in the truth, and you've just given it to me. Goodbye.
Rue pressed against the viewing window, knowing there was no hope of being able to spot the damned journalist so far below. People milled around like so many ants on the ground below. He'd read somewhere that if a person dropped a coin on its edge from this height, it would cut through a man, splitting him in two. He had a problem. If he didn't do something about Merlin now, he might not get the opportunity again before it was too late. He had to stop that story getting out. His privacy afforded him a certain standard of living. Exposed, his life could never be the same again. It really was as simple as that. Merlin, consciously or not, had forced his hand. Behind him, the elevator doors began to close. He moved quickly to catch it.
Hello again?
Rue was not in the mood to answer. He waited out the short descent.
Pardonnez-moi. Bougez-vous!
Then pushed his way through the doors before they were fully open, elbowing between the next wave of tourists, eager to make their way up to the observation platform without the climb. He couldn't see Merlin. Not that there was any guarantee the journalist had ever been there, no matter what he'd said. But if there was the slightest chance he was there, maybe watching from the safety of a nearby cafe to note how Rue reacted to his taunt, he had to try everything he could. If the guy wanted him to beg, then he'd beg. If he wanted to negotiate some exclusive deal to his story, then he'd negotiate, but only if he could control it. He tried the journalist's number again and turned through 360 degrees, scanning the faces around him. But Rue could hear a phone ringing. He moved his own cell phone away from his ear and started to walk toward the sound. He pushed through a family.
Hey, watch it!
Barging between mother and father and sending the kids scattering. The commotion caused heads to turn. Rue saw one in particular, a reflexive glance followed by the fight or flight instinct kicking in. The man ran.
Wait!
More heads turned in his direction, everyone in the crowd thinking the call was for them. The man didn't stop. He ducked his head and quickened his pace, pushing through the gathered tourists as he aimed for the open spaces of the square and the streets beyond where he hoped to disappear. Rue tried to keep up with him, but people kept getting in the way, clustering around the shadow of the tower, seemingly oblivious to the rest of the world.
Stop!
Merlin had worked himself into open space and began to run faster. He had no intention of talking. Merlin glanced over his shoulder to be sure he was leaving Rue behind. There was nothing the old man could do. He couldn't keep up. Merlin didn't realize how close he was to the curb. His foot slipped.
No!
Je suis un médecin. Me laissez passer!
Rue watched as people rushed toward the journalist, the first few to help, while others gathered around, horrified. A woman in a heavy knit cardigan knelt over Merlin, her hand on his throat. She looked up at the crowd.
Il est mort.
Rue had known it from the angle of the fall, the way his body twisted on the black surface of the Parisian road.
Damn it.
Someone had called for help. The crush of bodies eased, people moving back as if the man's condition might be contagious. The doctor knelt beside the body. There was a briefcase lying in the middle of the road, having spun out of the dead man's grip. The photographs were almost certainly still inside. Merlin had been emphatic that they weren't his only copies. It was irrelevant if they were or weren't. If the police opened that case and saw all of those versions of the old man's face, it could only lead to questions. Rue worked his way around the crowd to the briefcase and picked it up, careful not to draw attention to himself. As the paramedics arrived, he slipped away through the slowly thinning crowd. Twenty years later. It was minus 7 degrees, closer to minus 15 with the wind chill factored in. The extreme conditions presented their own problems for filming, including static discharge ruining shot after shot. It was just bone-chillingly cold, and Anya Creed was going snowblind with the swirling flakes twisting and churning in the air as they turned the world to white. They were outside the tent, standing in the last bluster of the storm. An hour ago, it had been like Snowmageddon out there. Now there was air between the flakes, and she could see the high walls of the castle, meaning it was the perfect time for the establishing shot of the medieval site in the heart of winter. Anya had visited Carcassonne before, more than once, but never in the midst of potentially fatal weather conditions.
You ready to go again, Anya?
Philippe Ayar, the cameraman, hoisted the camera onto his shoulder.
Yeah, let's do this.
Standing on her mark, she waited for the telling beep indicating she was good to go, then started talking to the camera as if she hadn't taken a 3-hour break waiting for the worst of the storm to pass.
Overlooked by the medieval fortress, the Cité de Carcassonne, the land behind me, has been the site of a settlement since Neolithic times. The Romans were among the first to take advantage of its strategic position and occupied the same hilltop until the fall of the Western Empire and the incursion of the Visigoths.
And cut. That was great. Let me adjust the lighting a bit and we'll continue.
The call came out of the blue. Garin listened to the voice on the other end of the line, unsure whom he was talking to, and incredibly curious as to how he had managed to get hold of his private number. Both problems were tempered by the fact that the man had a job that he was interested in. It wasn't every day a gig turned up that piqued his interest, and this time it wasn't all about the money.
Obviously, given the nature of the artifacts I am looking to acquire, this is a sensitive undertaking. But I have been led to understand that you are the man for the job.
Well, I'd say that rather depends on a combination of things, but right now I'm listening, which puts you ahead of the game. So, let's put the bush over there and stop beating about it, shall we?
By all means.
What are you looking for?
After the lure of the cloak and dagger approach, the worst thing that could happen now was that voice would spoil everything by asking for something mundane. There was nothing more disappointing. There was no joy in locating something bland, even if it involved a great deal of money. No, the thrill of the chase, the great hunt, the glittering prize, they were all part of the package. If one of them was missing from a job, the likelihood of him getting out of bed to deal with it was poor.
The initial task is a relatively simple retrieval job. I would like you to locate the private papers of Guillaume Marchand, a scribe at the church court in Rouen for the years 1430 and 31.
Marchand?
The name rang a distant bell, but that was nothing next to the blaring klaxon the date and place set off in his head. The year 1431 was burned in his memory. It was the end and the beginning of all things. It was the date of Joan of Arc's trial and execution, and the beginning of the curse that saw him walking this earth more than 500 years later.
You have my attention.
I had rather hoped I might. Alas, the papers are no longer there, so you will need to be, creative? Guillaume made his notes in French, and they were later translated into Latin, with 5 copies made. The French original and 3 of the transcribed Latin copies are in private collections, and unfortunately, getting access to them is next to impossible.
So by retrieval, you mean theft?
Garin had never been above breaking the law. The risk only added an extra thrill.
Ah, no, no. Actually, I want you to find me one of the missing copies.
How can you be so sure that they still exist? Do you have a lead on one of them? Evidence, perhaps, that there is another copy that hasn't been destroyed?
Sadly, no. I am laboring purely under the assumption that what is lost can be found, and that you are the right man to track them down.
Remind me again who recommended me.
Remind? I didn't actually say a first time.
Suffice it to say it was a most impeccable source, or I wouldn't be talking to you now.
That's really not saying very much, is it?
And yet it speaks volumes, if you care to think about it for a moment.
All right, let's assume this mysterious benefactor knows his stuff and that I am indeed the man for the job. Why do you want these papers? What makes them special, apart from the fact that they're nearly 600 years old?
Please don't take me for a fool, Mr. Braden. I am sure that you know full well why a scholar such as myself would be interested in documents created in Rouen in that particular year.
Do I?
I'll put it this way. If you don't, then I will have to reconsider the recommendation and believe that I have made a gross error in judgment.
So these documents relate to the trial of Joan of Arc?
That's more like it. No need to be coy. As I said, these papers are just the first of several artifacts I am seeking. In the interests of full disclosure, I will email a complete list once we have agreed upon a fee for your services.
Garin's mind raced to an extortionate figure. After all, if the man was as determined to get hold of these artifacts as he sounded, he was ripe for a little extortion.
$3 million, plus expenses.
Dollars or euros?
Euros. And this is purely for the papers. Anything else I turn up is extra. If I can't find them, you don't pay me. Fair?
Of course.
Garin was glad that the caller could not see the smile that had spread across his face. He wasn't smiling because he was looking forward to the challenge of the hunt, though that would normally be the case. Garin wasn't the kind of man who chased legends of history's monsters. He had gone toe-to-toe with more than his fair share of them. He left that sort of thing to Anya Creed. No, he was smiling because he knew the exact location of one of the two missing transcriptions of Guillaume Manchon's papers. They were currently locked up safe and sound in a vault in Rue's house. Sometimes it was just too easy. After wrapping the afternoon taping, Anya and Philippe had made plans to meet back at the hotel for dinner a little while later. Now, sated, they were driving away from the restaurant. The food had been Provençal cuisine, offered in rustic, homey surroundings. Simple, healthy, but tasty too. Farm fresh. It had been Philippe's recommendation. Anya always preferred eateries frequented by the local population to tourist traps offering authentic food.
Are you okay? You seem distracted.
It's all good. Just thinking.
Sounds dangerous.
Isn't it always?
They were heading back to the site to take a few night shots with the castle lit up in the distance. It was always good to hit the atmospheric stuff when the sun was down. It added to the mystique. Anya couldn't shake the thought that she had been followed on her way back from the afternoon shoot by two men in a silver Mercedes. Had it been Brooklyn instead of the south of France, she would have been worried about carjacking or insurance scammers intending to cause a collision so they could sue. But neither happened. Philippe kept telling her stories about growing up in the area.
And this story is true, I swear. On our farm, my grandmère would stain her toes purple, crushing grapes, and my grandpère would make cheese that smelled almost exactly the same as my grandmère's purple feet.
Oh, come on, you're making that up.
100% true, I swear on it.
As they drove, Anya glanced in the rearview mirror every few minutes to see if anyone was following them.
Snap out of it, there's no one there.
Then there was the time the fattest pigs got loose.
When Anya and Philippe arrived back in Carcassonne, the location where they'd been filming earlier was covered in 3 inches of fresh snow, though mercifully the night was clear and crisp, with not so much as a flurry to be seen. They moved around, looking for a better angle, where the spotlights accentuated the harsh old stones and served as a great reminder of just how old the fortress was.
Inside, good work. Different aspect, very mean and moody. It would give the shoot an air of foreboding.
He opened his case, pulling out the camera and beginning the prep work before they started shooting properly.
I get what you're saying, but a distance shot, looking up at me with the wall rising up to tower over me, could look pretty impressive.
You're the boss.
Anya skimmed through her rough notes, even though she'd read them dozens of times and knew them inside out. It was a compulsion. She could recite this stuff in her sleep. That was just the way her mind worked. She couldn't wipe it away, even if she wanted to. She swept her hair from her face.
Ready.
The spotlight on the side of the camera threw her features into stark relief, a perfect accompaniment for the tale of murder, witchcraft, and heresy she was about to tell.
In his book, Practica Inquisitionis Heretice Pravitatis, Conduct of the Inquisition into Heretical Wickedness, the Inquisitor Bernard Guy wrote a section related to sorcerers and diviners and the invokers of demons. His work proves beyond the shadow of any doubt that the Inquisition was concerned with the idea of witchcraft 165 years before the publication of the Malleus Maleficarum, and refutes the notion that paganism in France had been suppressed by the year 1000.
Almost too late. Anya launched herself away from the wall and shoved Philippe aside. He managed to hang onto his camera as he fell.
Merde! Sire, c'était quoi?
What the hell?
Anya looked up at the top of the wall, at a loss to understand how the huge slab could have fallen, and not seeing anyone on top of the wall who might have thrown it.
Are you all right?
She turned to see an older man in a wheelchair. The woman pushing him had turned an unhealthy shade of white.
Thanks to you.
I don't even know what possessed me to look up. I was just enjoying listening to your recounting of ancient history. I assume it's for a news bulletin? Has something happened?
Oh, no. I work for a cable TV show called Chasing History's Monsters. We're filming a segment about Bernard Guy, the Inquisitor.
The man offered a polite smile that spoke volumes.
Oh, I'm afraid I haven't heard of that.
No reason you would, though it's a good show. Really, thanks again.
Anya noticed that his left hand was trembling, just a slight tremor. He saw the direction of her gaze and offered a rueful smile.
My affliction.
I'm sorry.
It's perfectly all right, my dear. I'm just glad my big mouth could save the day, and that you and your colleague are in one piece.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.